How many join? No, but I crossed that number. Okay, good afternoon to all of you. I think many students are still sleeping. Shall I start, Akshay? Okay, I'm going to talk to you about a very interesting lesion that is related to ovary. Okay, my memory goes back to 1986 or 87, I think. I was doing diploma in clinical pathology. I was in Bowring Hospital along with my fellow colleague, Dr. Ravi Kumar, who owns RV Diagnostic Laboratory in Bangalore. So we were grossing. I was writing down and he was grossing the specimen. So a huge cyst was sent for histopathology. So he put it on the tray and we knew by the consistency. I told you cyst. What will the cyst contain? Fluid, right? So definitely when we put a or when we just start cutting or start opening it, the fluid would definitely the once we rupture it, so it will spill. So carefully he kept it, kept the cutting tray in the sink and then made a nick. So he extended it as we expected. The fluid, it did not come out with under that pressure or tension. So when do you expect the fluid to come out of the cyst like that forcibly? When it is tensed and a fluid which has to be like a transudate, not a very thick consistency and all that. So why was this? Then he extended the cut, so thick fluid started coming out. He put his hand inside, the gloved hand inside. And he caught something, caught hold of something, and he showed. It was a perfect, such round ball-like structure. Very, very soft. So he took out one, and I was taught by Dr. Krishnamurti there. So he used to make us preserve all the good, nice specimens for the museum and all that. So there was a big bucket with formalin. So he put that ball inside. Then again, his hand went inside. So he wanted to see initially because with the fluid, there is something inside the cyst. So if you can stand there, I can see you better, I think. You can sit also. Okay. So again, Ravi Kumar's hand goes inside. He takes out another ball. Same. So five times he repeats and such nice, well-made, ball. So when we make laddu also, it doesn't, come out to be so unless you use a machine or something. But it was so soft to handle. So what could that be? He wondered. So I was just thinking, at the same time, if somebody, a non-medico, sees it, then he would say some five cricket balls in the abdomen of a lady and all that, they would have correlated. So similar, that experience I just, remembered now. And the experience, another experience I had, a similar cyst started opening. Okay, so much of this material inside, so much of this material. Can you see? Is it visible? This one? Okay. What is this? Is a phone call cut it? What is this? How does this look like? See, such well-made mulberry-like structures, right? This is a sample. Part of it I have put it in one of the jars. Still, I have lots of it. What is this material? What is this? Anybody who can answer? Who can tell me what it is? Is it clearly visible? Can you see this? See, this is not man-made. It's disease-made. See, what is this? I've just closed this lid. Otherwise, with a gloved hand, I would have shown you the consistency of this. Tell me, what is this? Yeah, what is it? What is this? It is not stony hard. It doesn't have calcium at all. It is not at all hard. What is it? See, you know the slide that I have projected. So by looking at it, you know what topic I'm going to teach you. You know, this slide, these slides were prepared by Dr. Nandini. So my slides are not like this. So I have not even put the objective of today's class. So slightly deviating because they're all young teachers. They need to learn and they're helping me also. And by making a PPT, maybe you think, oh, they're helping a teacher. No, I am helping them to learn. So that is the way I've given them my notes also and references also to make the PPT. So teratoma, what does teratoma contain? Anybody who's answered? No. Sleeping in front of the computer or with your mobile on. Please don't do that. Okay, so this was sebaceous material. Sebaceous material, so secreted by the sebaceous glands. Yes, correct. Ananya and
Alina.
Correct, dermoids. But what does it contain? Pultaceous material, you say. What does that pultaceous material mean to you? It's predominantly the sebaceous material. Okay, see how it has got congregated. That material which is there, which lies in the fluid, which is there in the cyst, you know. So by constant movement, it takes all these shapes. So sebaceous material, that is so. That is why it is so soft. It is so fatty. So whenever we gross, we know that there's a teratoma dermoides that is sent for histopathology. We usually cut that specimen at the end because our gloves become very greasy, dirty and oily and all that. Okay, so let's learn about teratoma, the objective objectives of today's class. So I'll just define teratoma. What is teratoma? Then I'm going to talk about teratoma with respect to the one that occurs in the ovary because it is so special. Then we're going to classify teratomas. And in brief, I'll tell you what microscopic features we are going to see. So how do we define teratoma? All of you know that teratoma is a tumor that is derived from the totipotential cells. Teratoma is a tumor that is derived from totipotent cells, germ cells. You say germ cells. And you have seen teratomas elsewhere in the body. What are the sites where you have seen teratomas? Usually for undergraduates, we say midline. Then, anything? Why am I touching here? Angular dermoids. Okay, so midline, then angular dermoid, then both the ovaries and the testis. Then, wherever we see the germ cells, not just externally in the midline, starting from the pineal gland, mediastinum. So everywhere we can see teratomas occurring. So teratomas are tumors which are derived from totipotential cells. And when we say totipotential cells, what are they composed of? So the cells which are the layers that are derived from these germ cells are ectoderm, endoderm, mesoderm. You can pull a chair and sit. It's okay, why? Difficult to carry a chair with you. So ectoderm, endoderm, mesoderm, three layers. So cytogenetic studies have revealed that these tumors arise from a single germ cell, that is ovum, after its first meiotic division, because we are talking about the ovarian teratomas. So we have lots of specimens of ovarian teratomas that you have to see. There's one specimen that is kept for your identification as well. So when we classify teratomas, we classify it as, so you can't see the matter that is striped within. Okay, this is teratoma. We classify it as mature, immature, specialized. Okay, the three categories which you are not able to see: mature, immature, specialized. Okay, so mature teratoma is further classified as solid teratomas and cystic teratomas. So cystic teratoma is also called as mature cystic teratoma, or in simple words, dermoid cyst. Okay, apart from the skin where we see this, most common site of cystic teratoma is ovaries. Okay, so that's how we differentiate ovarian teratomas from testicular teratomas. Testicular teratomas most often, most commonly a solid, whereas ovarian teratomas most commonly a cystic. That's why we call this as dermoid cyst. Okay, so next is immature teratoma. So once the teratoma is immature, it is malignant as well. Whereas the first category, benign or mature, mature is benign. So this is immature. Then third category is called a specialized teratoma. There are two specialized varieties of teratoma that we talk about. So one is called a struma ovarii and the other is carcinoid. Okay, so specialized teratomas are also called as monodermal teratomas. Monodermal or specialized teratomas. So what are the two entities that you should remember under this? Carcinoid and struma ovarii. Yes. So let us just talk about benign cystic teratoma or the dermoid cyst of the ovary. So most common tumor occurs in reproductive age group, sometimes at an elderly age also. And many a times what happens is it would not have caused any symptoms or signs at all. So patient would nicely harbor this. And when for some other reason this patient goes for an abdominal scan or just a simple X-ray, so then suddenly they find calcium deposits, not just calcium deposits. So one surprise finding is they find tooth or teeth in pelvis. You get shocked. So where the tooth or teeth has to be, and some people are telling, oh, whether this lady has swallowed, the tooth which was loosened or all that. Okay, that's for a common man when he sees that. So this word teratoma is derived, cyst, dermoid cyst is derived from Greek, we say skin, because dermoid cyst, dermis. So it has epidermis and dermis, because most often in these teratomas, the common finding we see is ectodermal derivatives. So what are the ectodermal derivatives? The skin and the adenexal. So when I say skin, what do you see microscopically? Epidermis, okay, and the keratin, then the dermis. What does dermis contain? Yeah, so collagen. So, this smooth muscle, along with that, the adenexal structures. So, sweat glands, sebaceous glands, all the eccrine glands which are there. So, teratomas are usually unilateral, but they're bilateral in 10% of cases. We have seen many which are bilateral. This is quite common tumor which you also now, you've just started your career now, so you also keep seeing many of this. I still remember one of the teratomas when I cut open. So, I could see half of the jaw. So nicely, developed with all the teeth. It was such nice this thing. So these grossly it is cystic because dermoid cyst, and the cyst size varies. It may measure up to 10 to 15 centimeters. It could be smaller also. It could be larger also, as I was mentioning the first case. You know, such a huge teratoma dermoid cyst which was there. And usually smooth surface. So when we just look at the cyst, or when we just hold it with our gloved hands, we can definitely make out it is dermoid cyst. In contrast to the mucinous cyst adenomas or the serous cyst adenomas. So serous cyst adenoma has a very thin wall and tense with that clear fluid inside which you can make out. It could be altered also due to infection or anything. So when you just lift this dermoid cyst, the consistency also, it feels so soft. External surface is so smooth, but if you just try touching the surface, it leaves a depression. What does it tell you? It is not just the cystic serous fluid or mucinous fluid that is there. So it is soft material that is within. So what can you see in this picture? What can you see in this picture? Hair, okay. So hair is very well seen or visible. Okay. So on cut section, we see that pultaceous, you know, it is really dirty. I tell you that dirty pultaceous material which comes out along with tangled hair, lot of hair. So we try to wash it and then look for the inner surface. So inner surface, when we look at it, usually these cysts have a protuberance in the center or at the periphery somewhere. So we call that as a dermoid nipple, or we call this as a Rokitansky's tubercle. And this area is very important for us, because if you just palpate this area, you can make out that it is very hard. And it is at this area that we see the cartilage, bone, teeth or tooth, everything would be there. And this is an area of interest for us because microscopy we have to study. So we take sections from Rokitansky's tubercle. Okay. So dermoid cyst, I've told you how it appears grossly. On cut section, pultaceous material and hair, tuft of hair comes out, and inner wall, if we see, so there will be a protuberance or a tubercle-like elevation, which is called as dermoid nipple or Rokitansky's tubercle, and at this area that we could see. And grossly, you may see a lot of fat, you may see, and this tubercle will be very nicely many a times covered with skin, exactly skin how it is on the surface, you know, you can see that with a lot of hair covering that. And you see bone, cartilage. How does cartilage appear grossly? It is bluish and translucent. How do you identify fat grossly? You have seen yellowish, okay, yellowish and greasy. So this is what usually we see. So this is just a pictorial demonstration of the same dermoid cyst, what we can see. And this is an uncomplicated cyst I'm talking about. Most of these cysts have a long pedicle. Okay, so what happens when they have a long pedicle? Sometimes these women with dermoid cyst can come with an acute abdomen. How? Why? Rupture is one, okay. Torsion, when it has a pedicle, torsion. So when it gets twisted on itself, so it causes ischemia, gangrene. So that's how many of patients present also. Okay. So I've just told you what we see grossly in dermoid cyst. Now it is for you to identify. Okay, I've just taken few pictures from the Google image store. What do you see here? Tooth. Is it only one tooth? Teeth. Okay, anything else you can comment? Can you look at these teeth and say? Yeah, most of them are molar and premolar, right? Yes. What else can you make out? This is washed. You know, the contents are washed. Look at one surface of the wall here. What is the color? Blackish or bluish, right? So this could be due to, yeah, ischemia, hemorrhage. That could be due to ischemia. So you can see so many. Now, what can you appreciate? So tuft of hair coming out of the cut section of the ovary. Okay. So now, tell me any other condition you see so much of hair like this? Correct. So when people keep swallowing the hair, right? So we have, I think, two specimens are they're there. So Trichobezoar was one. So the entire stomach was full of this hair. So when it gets congregated in the stomach or intestine, whatever, it takes the shape of that. Okay. So, but this is a cyst which is cut open, and the hair, tuft of hair, is coming out along with some greasy or thick material. What do you understand by looking at it? What could be the content of this cyst? This has retained the shape of the ovary, right? So one more tumor you should remember, which retains the shape of the ovary, is Krukenberg tumor. Krukenberg tumor is usually bilateral, so it is metastatic ovarian carcinoma. Metastatic carcinoma in the ovary, primary could be breast or GIT, mucin secreting adenocarcinoma. See, content of the cyst, is it serous fluid? Is it mucinous fluid? You have not touched it, you're just looking at it. Why mucinous? No. So this is how, you know, dermoid cyst appears. It looks like it is filled with something. Okay. So mucinous looks still glistening. Even on gross, you can make out. And mucinous cyst adenoma is usually multiloculated. So even on the surface, you can see those bocillations, bocillated appearance. Whereas teratoma dermoid cyst, I told you, has a smooth surface. Yes. Now, what do you see here? Okay, multiloculated, right? Before that, bilateral. Okay, this cyst is bilateral. So it has some blackish material. We should look at the closer view of it and all that. And it looks like dermoid cyst only, the pultaceous material and all. So one side it is larger, the other side it is smaller. And anything else in the myometria? What do you see here in the myometrium? There is a leiomyoma, intramural leiomyoma. Just look at it. Small, tiny, gray, white, well-defined tumor. Okay. So that is the gross appearance of ovarian teratoma, which is dermoid cyst. So if we want to contrast this with testicular teratomas, what is the first point I told you? Testicular teratomas are always solid, whereas ovarian teratomas most often are cystic. Okay, so most often ovarian teratomas are benign. Okay, that's why we say benign cystic teratoma, mature cystic teratoma. So mature also tells us that it is benign. Okay, otherwise we add a prefix benign. So whereas most of the testicular teratomas are malignant. So when we say malignant, you can add another word, that is immature. Okay, immature, malignant, solid. Three things for testicular teratoma. Whereas here they are benign, cystic, mature. Three things for ovarian teratomas. Yes. So when we look at this microscopy, what do we see? Very nicely, we see skin lining the interior of the cyst. The cyst is lined by skin. So all of you have learnt in first year MBBS histology how the skin appears. So it looks exactly like that, but lot of keratin we can see. And what along with this keratin and hair we see here, right, grossly. So lot of hair follicles, and so much of keratin and hair follicles that these hair follicles, you know, they may grow irregularly also, and some of them may rupture, giving rise to giant cell reaction. So keratin is normal to the body, hair is also normal to the body, but both of them elicit foreign body giant cell reaction. Okay, so when they're out of their place. So then we see all the adenexa, predominantly the sebaceous glands, because the cyst would be filled with sebaceous material. Yes. Then other structures are bone, cartilage, fat, intestine, brain, respiratory epithelium, choroid plaque. So all derived from mesoderm, endoderm, and ectoderm. All this derivatives would be there. But most often, the most common is this. What do you see in this microscopy now? The picture. You can make out the epidermis. Yes, the skin. Then, the follicle here and lot of sebaceous glands. Okay, and some amount of inflammatory cells also there. So, thus, viewing a benign cystic teratoma, so if you look at one area, you may see hair, pultaceous material and adenexal structures. If you just move and go to the next field, you may see cartilage. So, move and go to the next field, you may see bone. Okay, all different derivatives would be seen. It's very difficult for you to see all these under one low power field or high power field. So, it's got, we say, variegated appearance. So, that's why this, we say, has a kaleidoscopic pattern or variegated appearance. So, just see here, hair follicle we are seeing, sebaceous glands are there. So, this is an immature hair follicle, young one. Then the collagenous tissue which is within or in between. So, all these are ectodermal derivatives. Now, what can you make out here? What is this bluish area? This is cartilage. Okay. And this one? This is again endodermal derivative. It looks like the epithelium. If we have a closer look, if you look at it, then probably if we see cilia, then we say respiratory epithelium here. And what are these clear spaces that you are seeing? What is this tissue? It appeared grossly yellowish in color. Fat, adipose tissue. This is adipose tissue. And all this is fibrocollagenous tissue. So, you are seeing mesodermal derivatives in this area, that is cartilage and fat. Yes. So, this is a diagrammatic representation where you are able to see, this is from your book, stratified squamous epithelial lining. Then there are glands, endodermal derivatives, glands, any type of gland could be seen. Then mesoderm, adipose tissue is there. Then smooth muscle is shown. Then columnar lining and cartilage. Okay. This is similar to the picture which is there by its side. So, how we see this under the microscope, and when we represent it diagrammatically, this is how it sees. So, now carry home message for you is microscopically when we are looking at a teratoma, so it shows derivatives of ectoderm, mesoderm, endoderm. May not be all the time, all the derivatives need not be there, but definitely ectodermal derivatives like the skin and the adenexa lining would be present. So, what complications can we expect? You said benign, right? But complications. So, the cyst can rupture, the rupture of the cyst sometimes, but more common is torsion of the cyst. So, presenting as acute ectodermal. And one complication we must and should remember is sometimes this teratoma, though we said mature cystic teratoma is benign, it can undergo malignant transformation. So, what do we call that as? We call that as teratoma with malignant change or teratoma with malignant transformation. Okay. So, now there are tricky terminologies that we should know. One is teratoma with malignant transformation. One of the element here, what we have seen, can undergo malignant transformation. So, we said, we kept on telling about the ectodermal derivative, that is squamous cell carcinoma. So, if it undergoes malignant change, what do we see? Squamous cell carcinoma. So, teratoma with malignancy is, one could be squamous cell carcinoma. So, I showed you a few glands here. So, the glands could undergo malignant transformation. What happens? Adenocarcinoma. Okay. Most common is squamous cell carcinoma. No complication. The teratoma undergoing malignant change is rare. It's only 1%. And if it happens, the common malignancy that we see is a squamous cell carcinoma. So we call that as teratoma with malignant transformation. Okay. Remember this terminology. I'm going to ask you again. Then second is, immature teratoma. Let us know only a few points related to immature teratoma. So what is immature teratoma? What did we see in a mature teratoma? The contents, they were all mature. We saw all well-formed epidermis and the skin, adenex, cartilage and all that. So that composed of mature elements. So immature teratoma, as the terminology says, one thing I told you is that immature teratomas are solid tumors. They're not cystic like the mature cystic teratoma. Sometimes mature cystic teratoma can have immature component along with. Then the immature component appears solid. Okay. So immature teratoma contains immature or embryonal structures. Immature embryonal structures, in contrast to the mature or the adult structures of benign teratoma. So immature hyaline cartilage, we say, still not totally developed. So contains, in addition, primitive neuroectodermal elements. This element is very important for us to say if this teratoma is immature. So what should be present? Primitive neuroectodermal elements. So they are more common, such immature teratomas are more common in prepubertal adolescents and young women under 20 years of age. So is immature teratoma malignant or benign? Malignant. So now we have heard of two types of malignant teratomas. One is teratoma, benign cystic teratoma with malignant transformation. Then second is immature teratoma. So what is the criteria to make a diagnosis of immature teratoma? Presence of immature elements like immature cartilage, immature bone, everything, plus neuroectodermal, primitive neuroectodermal tissue, where they'll all be like neuroblastoma, how we see, the neuroepithelial tubules would be there. Gross appearance, solid and usually unilateral. On cut section, it has variegated appearance, revealing areas of hemorrhage, necrosis. So whenever we talk about any tumor that is malignant, we know there's a lot of hemorrhage, necrosis. We know the cause for ischemia, hemorrhage, necrosis, tumor necrosis factor, everything. So tiny cysts and admixture of various elements. So microscopy, parts of the tumor, we may see mature cartilage, but we look at the presence of immature elements, immature tissues of embryonic appearance. And immature tissue elements may differentiate towards cartilage. So immature is there, it may mature and differentiate also, glandular tissue, neural tissue and all that. And they're usually distributed in spindle shaped, mixoid or undifferentiated cells. So an important factor, so we grade these immature teratomas. So we grade, you should go back and read Ackerman. Very nicely he gives how you grade this immature teratoma. For undergraduate, this is not required. So I don't want to put extra things in their brain. Okay, they should know immature teratoma is immature elements and neural elements which are immature. Okay, so based on how many sections and how many, every section, how much part has these immature elements, we grade this. So neural tissue, immature neural tissue is very important. Whereas in a cystic teratoma, normal, we see well-developed brain also. Nice brain tissue. So when I say the mature cystic teratoma has brain tissue, so I remember Dr. Yanthan. Yanthan was my senior in Bangalore Medical College. So when I was in third year, he was in final year. Then when I came to Davangere, JJ Medical College, he was doing his PG. He was from Nagaland. There were very few well-educated people in Nagaland those days. So we used to tell him, you go back and you become health minister and all that. Very brainy chap, He was so short and good musician and all that. And he could not clear his MD, some problem he went off. So every time, we saw this mature cystic teratoma with a lot of brain, his question was, are these people very brainy? After excision, that extra brain is removed, right? So that was a question he used to ask everybody. Must be very brainy because extra brain tissue there, So teratoma makes me remember Dr. Yanthan. I don't know whether he remembers me or not. Very nice person. Okay. So immature neural tissue can undergo maturation even at the site of metastasis. So why metastasis came here? When we talk of malignant, So second thing is they metastasize. Okay, so that is how over a period of time it metastasizes, and we see immature elements at metastatic sites also. So immature teratoma may contain areas of other germ cell tumors such as endodermal sinus tumor, and so more than this, it is not immature teratoma. So two malignant types of teratomas we said: benign cystic teratoma, that is mature cystic teratoma with malignant transformation. Second is immature teratoma. Third is what is called as teratocarcinoma. So when somebody says there is teratocarcinoma, what does it mean to you? What is the origin of teratoma? It arises from germ cells. Okay, so if you know the classification, Dr. Disha has taught you the classification of ovarian tumors, WHO classification, under germ cell tumors. So she has told you endodermal sinus tumor, dysgerminoma, embryonal carcinoma, everything. So when they coexist, when embryonal carcinoma coexists with teratoma, then it is called as teratocarcinoma. So can choriocarcinoma occur here? Germ cell. Yes, choriocarcinoma also can occur, that is non-gestational choriocarcinoma, we said all this. So teratoma with malignant transformation usually is squamous cell carcinoma, immature teratoma with immature neural elements. Third is teratocarcinoma. When we say teratocarcinoma, it's not teratoma with squamous cell carcinoma. So it is teratoma with embryonal carcinoma or other germ cell malignant tumor. What do we see here? There is an ovarian tumor that is shown as part of cut section. What is the color? Can you make a difference in the color there? So part of it is so blackish. Okay, so that could be hemorrhage necrosis. Then microscopically, when we see, all these are immature rosettes, neural rosettes, we say. Okay, with the central lumen. So this is an immature teratoma. Only that part is shown there. So prognosis. So we have to know how to grade these immature teratomas. Tomorrow you should tell me. So grade one tumors having relatively mature elements and confined to the ovary have a good prognosis, whereas grade three immature teratomas with metastasis have extremely poor prognosis. Yes. So that is about the teratoma mature and teratoma immature. So what was the third category, which was not seen, but I told you? Okay, it was seen in the other computer. I don't know what happened to the words you had typed there. Monodermal or specialized teratoma. So what comes to your mind when I say monodermal or specialized teratoma? There's something special. That means, yeah, I told you carcinoid and stroma ovarian. See, carcinoid, we teach you in detail when we talk about GIT, tumors of GIT. And carcinoid, we've already told you while dealing with acute appendicitis. Okay, one of the tumor that is commonly seen in the tip of the appendix. Okay, it may not cause obstruction because it is in the tip. So that's why when we gross appendix, we usually give cross sections, yes, and tip we always cut because hidden tumors are there. And how do they appear? Very nice yellowish tumors. Okay, so why yellow? What do they produce? Everything we teach you in detail. Okay, so monodermal or specialized teratoma is another category. So this is a 5 marker or a 3 marker question, that is short essay or short answer question. So two specialized teratomas we should remember. One is carcinoid of the ovary and the second is struma ovarii. Okay, so very this is self-explanatory. Struma ovarii, what is struma? Yeah, struma means something related to the thyroid, right? So it is a Latin word that means neck or goiter. Goiter, we said, is gutter or throat. Okay, so this is neck or this thing. So struma ovarii, what is struma ovarii? So we have seen many of the struma ovarii also. So it is a teratoma that is composed exclusively of thyroid tissue. So the percentage, you know, we fix it, how much thyroid should be present. And it is recognizable grossly and microscopically also. So when we just cut the ovary and see, it looks like thyroid. So we show it to others to identify the organ. Many people say, "Hi, it is thyroid." Because if there is a, along with it, if there is a fallopian tube and fimbriel end, yeah, they can say it is ovary and all. So that's how it looks. Same thyroid tissues. If you are in India also, you look like this. So if you are abroad also, you like, but your appearance, you know, the way you dress may differ, right? So all that. So that is the thing. So most often the tumor has the appearance of a follicular adenoma. The SINI is thyroid follicles, and that rarely we say it could hyperfunction, and very rarely, and produce hyperthyroidism. Very rarely papillary carcinoma can develop in the thyroid, that is ectopic thyroid, like, you know. So here we don't just call it as ectopic thyroid because it is a part of teratoma. So monodermal or specialized teratoma, we say. Yeah. So I should have taken other pictures. This is where, you know, it looks like a thyroid. Okay. And right side, a focus of papillary carcinoma, solid follicular trabecular pattern in the stroma ovary. So this thyroid you can appreciate. No, nice follicles with, what do they contain, the follicles? Thyroglobulin, colloid. So how does colloid appear? Homogeneous eosinophilic. So you can see at the periphery, those scalloped margins. That is how the cells, you know, the resorption of thyroglobulin occurs there. So that's about stroma ovarii. So the thyroid can hyperfunction there. So next is carcinoid tumor of the ovary as a part of monodermal or specialized ovarian teratoma. So this is ovarian teratoma arising from the cells of origin, you know, Argentafin cells or Kalchitsky cells, whatever we say, of the intestinal epithelium in the teratoma. So ovarian carcinoid also may hyperfunction. So what syndrome does that lead to with excess of 5-HT serotonin and all that? Carcinoid syndrome. Very rare, you know, for this to produce carcinoid syndrome. See, another rare combination. So previously, we said both are present separately. Now they can be together, stromal carcinoid. So both, there are very rare combination of stroma ovarii and ovarian carcinoid. Yes. So now, you're going to see the specimen and identify that there are many of these specimens. So I think a tour has to be, I think I need to take you to our museum. Can you make out? Is it seen? Is the specimen seen?
Yes.
Yeah. What can you appreciate? Is it a cystic structure or a solid one? Sister solid. Solid? Is it a solid? See, so much is empty here. This is sister. And this is where, from where the hair is projecting. So that is a protrusion or the Rokitansky tubercle. Okay, all other material, the sebaceous material is washed away. In spite of this, that can you make out the water, the museum fluid that we have added is so dirty. So in spite of washing it, still some amount of sebaceous material that is coming out. And so this is the diagnosis? Dermoid cyst. Dermoid cyst. So let us, there's one more. Let us see only two. Then for all others, I think let's have a museum tour. What can you make out here? What can you make out here?
No.
Seen? Yeah. What is it? See, can you make out this protrusion here? Such round, whitish one which is protruding. Mm-hmm. That is a large Rokitansky tubercle. Okay. So, we have cut it also. Look at the Rokitansky tubercle. It is covered with skin. Mm-hmm. That is skin. Have a close observation. That is skin. And cut section is showing yellowish area. So, we are seeing fat inside. It's something like, imagine a lipoma which is on the surface of the skin. And here, we are seeing tuft of hair. So, this looks like a biloculated ovarian cystic teratoma. Yes. So, that's about ovarian Teratomas in brief. Now the exercise for you is to go back and read about it, and I'm planning for another brain teaser for you. Probably next week I'll have that, and hope now you're able to define what is a teratoma and teratoma with respect to the ovary. So ovarian teratoma or the mature cystic teratoma or the dermoid cyst. You know what is the malignant counterpart of that, or teratoma malignant means immature teratoma, or teratoma with malignant transformation, or teratoma with combination of another germ cell tumor. Okay, so all the elements that are there in the teratoma, which are derived from all the three germinal layers. Okay, so I'll show you lots of specimens of teratoma ovary. So this is just the gross and microscopic appearance of teratoma of the ovary, a specimen which is there for your examination, ospin, and then for viva OC. Okay. So thank you. Attendance would be marked just now, and Akshay's responsibility to inform all his friends to attend all the classes. Okay. So advantage probably here of my classes, I would upload the same so that students who have missed can go through. And
just of the specimen, all the specimens are there on the desktop.
Okay, we can show that. So there are a few pictures. Okay, so you may see those pictures, and then okay, these are the pictures of the specimen which are mounted in our laboratory, in our museum. Can I move this? Okay. Short on one plus. Okay. Clarity is not there because this specimen is in the glass jar. Fine. Familiar with this? Just now you have seen. Okay. Yes. Same. Well, I thought there were extra pictures. Fine, you have seen this also. Yes. So you have seen one now hanging. It's not hanging. It's a part of this. It's mounted like that. Teratoma. This was along with the serous cystadenoma, the papillary serous cystadenoma. You can see this papillary projection and a larger cyst associated. That's it. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Hope you have heard and seen the specimens I showed you, and basics about teratoma, I'm sure you have understood, and you retain this knowledge what you have gained, because it's not just for your pathology examination. You know, don't read or learn anything for the sake of examination. So this is there. The learning that happens is for lifelong learning. Okay, so you may not choose pathology, doesn't matter, but you choose OBG or gynecology. So you're operating and sending us the specimen. Okay, doesn't matter. You do not take up that also. You're a surgeon, patient may come to you. Okay, you're not a surgeon, you're just a physician. In spite of that, patient may come to you. Okay, it's like because you're a doctor who is going to help people to cure their disease or heal their pain or whatever. Okay, so thank you. Get motivated. Self-motivation is very important. So keep reading. Open the books. You don't have books, I'm sure you have e-books, the soft copies. Otherwise learn. You know, internet has so much of it's an ocean knowledge, ocean of knowledge So keep learning. Okay. Thank you. Thanks a lot. And my young team here who have helped me to do this. So my work has become so easy now. So four of them are there with me to help. So I thank all of them for this. Thank you. Hope you enjoyed learning. Thank you.